Good afternoon and welcome to WMUR's Facebook Live with the Candidate Series. I'm WMUR Political Director Adam Sexton. These live streams are a chance for voters to hear directly and interact with candidates ahead of primary elections and for the candidates, of course, to take questions from our Facebook fans. Today we're talking with Democrat Steve Marchand, who is running for governor. Steve, thanks for joining us here.
Great to see you.
Sorry for my setup, but this is how the questions are going to come in here via Facebook on the comments section, and we'll get to those in a second.
Sure.
But let's just start with a little bit. You've been running since about 3 months into the Trump administration. Why did you feel it was important to jump into this race so quickly?
Well, first of all, it is very difficult to beat a first-term incumbent under the best of circumstances. And although I think this is going to be a strong year to be a Democrat, to run the same way that people running against a first-term incumbent typically do, well, we know the history. They usually are not successful. So if you want to make history, you've got to be willing to break history, and that explains the timing. The other thing is, this is a big moment in history. This is the messiest politics have been, I would argue, since Watergate, really in my lifetime. And I think that we need to define the future in an aspirational but very affirmative way. We need to be very direct about what we think the future of the Democratic Party, our state, and even our country should be. And there's no waiting when you have that kind of intensity about doing that kind of job.
Mm-hmm. And of course, Facebook users, you can use our comment section to ask your questions here of Steve Marchand. Let's see here. We do want to ask you a little bit about what you think this race is going to be all about in the primary. Obviously, you want to get to that general election. You talked about Governor Sununu. But what is the primary all about?
Well, certainly on one level, as I just said, this is a choice people have between a candidate who describes the past and somebody like myself who seeks to define the future. And that means that we have to take the mission and really get specific about what it is we need to do and how we need to do it. People that have followed my campaign over the last year and a half have seen I've been willing to be bold and specific to take positions that I believe represent the mainstream of our state, but that somebody, the people are waiting for leadership to say it out loud. I describe it as the vision to know where to go, the competence to know how to get there, and the courage to say it out loud with the energy of youth and optimism of an immigrant's kid.
So we do have our first question. They're coming out firing with fastballs here. Susan Peterson asks this. Good afternoon, and thank you for taking my question. Mr. Marchand, you signed a no fossil fuel money pledge, yet according to your campaign finance report, you took more than $6,000 from fossil fuel companies. And of course, I've just lost the comment here in the thread. We can get to the rest of that in a second, but it sounds like this question is, you're saying that you don't want to take this money, but this person is saying that you do have that money.
Well, that's not accurate. And I did take the pledge. And in fact, I'm the only person in either side of the aisle in this race, for example, who has opposed the Granite Bridge Project, which is a big natural gas project in southeastern New Hampshire. I think that moves us away from a clean energy future. I put out a comprehensive energy plan that would move us to 50% renewables by 2030. I've spoken with some of the folks that are in charge of that pledge, and we went through actually our campaign finance, and they were comfortable with what we've done. We have taken no corporate money, and it's virtually all individuals, over 90% from New Hampshire. So I'm very proud of the way we've raised the money, and I'm proud to be the only candidate that has really put forth a plan for a legitimately clean energy future.
Okay, there's some of the question here. Deborah Reed says, what will you do to help our seniors get affordable health care?
Well, I'm an advocate, first of all, for universal health care, regardless of one's age. I think that the way that we do health care in this country right now is a remnant of World War II, a totally different time in history, and it is killing our ability to grow our economy, for people to be able to leave a business, to start a business, to grow entrepreneurship. My family, when I was in high school, experienced a catastrophe when we didn't have insurance at a time. We had financial trouble in the early 90s. My mom had a heart attack while we did not have insurance, and it was an $80,000 medical bill from CMC Hospital, and it caused us to file bankruptcy. It's the number one reason people in this country file personal bankruptcy, a healthcare crisis. I know what it feels like to be at that end, you know, when you've hit the bottom, and it's part of the reason I have the passion and have had the passion for many years to move us towards a system of universal health care. Certainly in terms of making sure at the federal level that Medicare is there for everybody in their 60s and older to be able to have the assurance of quality health care. It has been an efficient system over the last 50 plus years of its existence, and I think if anything we need to expand that type of model to younger Americans, again with the goal eventually of universal health care.
Okay, I do want to get to Susan Peterson's question that was interrupted by the scrolling of all the comments. I apologize. So her real question here, she says, your campaign finance report, you took more than $6,000 from fossil fuel companies and executives. A, did you solicit these contributions? And why are fossil fuel interests investing in your candidacy if you are, as you say, opposed to fossil fuels?
Well, certainly, first of all, I've talked to the folks that were part of the pledge that we did take, and they have been satisfied with who those people were and that they were not executives with fossil fuel companies. We actually went through it with them line by line. So that's the first thing. The second thing is, I'm the only candidate on either side of the aisle who's taken that pledge in the first place. Other candidates will talk about campaign finance reform. I actually have a public funding plan that would eliminate all of this in future years. I want campaigns in the future to be able to raise virtually all their money in in-state, low-dollar individual contributions with a strong public match. And that means that no more corporate money at all. No PAC money, virtually no out-of-state money, and it would cap contributions at a much lower amount than is allowed right now. It is a much healthier way to raise money and addresses the legitimate concern. I am proud that about 99.8% of my money comes from individuals. It's over 90% in-state. It is by far the cleanest, healthiest way that anybody's raising money on either side of the aisle in this campaign. And again, I'm the only person that's put my neck out at all on a plan for 50% renewables for our electricity by 2030. That is a very aggressive plan, but other states in New England are doing it, so I know we can do it too. It'll create thousands of excellent jobs and dramatically change the mix. We over-rely on natural gas to a dramatic extent in New England. And if we do things like the NED pipeline in southwestern New Hampshire, the Granite Bridge project in southeastern New Hampshire, this will move us even further in the natural gas direction. That's the wrong direction, and it's why I'm the only candidate for governor who opposes the Granite Bridge pipeline.
So you've taken a very hardline stance on the liberal side on abortion. So Beth asks Steve Marchand, how can you support tax-funded abortion through all 9 months of pregnancy?
Well, first of all, 17 states already do it, including states that have had Republican governors that have signed what they call the Hyde Amendment repeal. Here's the thing. Regardless, it's a very difficult and it's a complicated personal decision. Nobody disputes that. However, in the eyes of the law, and I'm seeking to be governor of New Hampshire, this is a health care issue. And if it is, and I believe it is, then we need to make the following statement. You should not have more choice because you have more money, and less choice because you have less money. But right now, under Medicaid, the only women that can terminate a pregnancy with Medicaid dollars are life of the mother, incest, or rape. All other situations, if you don't have resources, you don't have access to legal, safe abortion. And let's be honest, in a lot of states and a lot of other situations, this conversation is not about whether or not somebody is going to terminate a pregnancy. It is going to be about whether or not they can safely terminate a pregnancy. This is about safe, legal access. If it is legal, it is, and under my plan, it will remain legal no matter what happens with Roe v. Wade, then we should treat it as if it is legal. And that means that we should repeal the Hyde Amendment, and we should do what Republican and Democratic governors have done around the country, lead on that issue, and create true equality of access.
We are live with Steve Marchand, a candidate for governor and Democrat, who is running in a primary against one candidate right now. And we want your questions to come through on the comments section here of this Facebook post. And please do ask whatever you'd like. The candidate is here to answer questions. Donna asks, what will your plan be as far as bringing in more refugees?
Well, first of all, I put out a specific plan relating to immigration, so a broader discussion than even refugees. The rhetoric about immigration over the last several years, including under President Trump, to me, it's hateful. It is un-American, and it flies in the face of much of what has made us successful as a state and as a country over the last couple of centuries. I am the son of immigrants myself. I'm from a couple miles from here on the west side of Manchester. My folks came down here in the 1960s, like a lot of folks in Manchester. French was the first language of the house, neither with a high school degree. Both started businesses. They worked their butt off. They're still working. My dad's 73, and he's still working, still paying a mortgage. That's the real world. And to me, what's going on right now, the question, I think, implies that I somehow want lots of refugees or undocumented immigrants to come in. The reality is this has been politicized to such an extent. The future of America's success and our state's success will be the embracing of immigration as a net positive to make us younger and to make us more entrepreneurial. And what the federal government is doing right now, it's the core part of my plan, that is asking local law enforcement agencies to play the role of ICE, to play the role of federal law enforcement. We already are stretched in terms of local law enforcement dollars to do local law enforcement, to be threatened by the Trump administration in a way that President Bush and Obama never did, which is to say, if you do not heed our request for extra detainment when you identify an undocumented immigrant, then we will threaten to take away federal dollars to local law enforcement. Not only is that illegal, it makes us less safe because immigrant communities in our communities are now afraid to interact with law enforcement, even if they're the victim or witness to a crime. So my policy says, as other states are doing, that we should take the pressure off of local law enforcement. Unless the background of an undocumented immigrant that is stopped for speeding or something like that involves a long list of serious crimes, if it's on that list, yes, heed the detainment request. But if it does not meet that list, if they do not have any kind of offense of that type in their background, do what they did under President Bush and President Obama, and let's put our resources to places that'll actually make us safer.
You said you did not want to encourage waves of undocumented immigrants coming here, but it's safe to say that you are encouraging New Hampshire to become a sanctuary state, which you would do if you were governor.
Yeah, look, it's a four-point plan. And one element of it is, this is an important point that I think a lot of people that are speaking in anti-immigrant language try to fuzzy up. We should comply, in fact, we are required to comply with federal law. The key here is that those requests that ICE will make when you arrest somebody and they take the fingerprints, they send it to the FBI, the FBI sends it to ICE. ICE, if they see something, they can make what they call a 48-hour detainment request to begin deportation. This did not happen with regularity under either Bush or Obama unless there was a serious offense found during the fingerprint check. Now they do it for virtually everybody or else they threaten to take away your money. This is illegal, and it is a way that allows us to follow federal law. We have to follow federal law, but we have discretion beyond that in terms of what we as states and local governments shall do. And in states both led by Republicans and Democrats, they are increasingly helping local law enforcement by helping define the rules of engagement for the request made by the federal government. But those things that are required, we must and we will continue to do.
Okay, question coming in from Sandy Belknap. Thoughts about public-private partnerships to clean up EPA Superfund sites in New Hampshire? I'm concerned that after 20-plus years, there's suddenly a remedy readily available, especially in light of so many EPA regulation rollbacks, especially concerned about the Mohawk Tannery in my Nashua neighborhood.
Well, one of the things I've learned over a couple years of traveling the state as a candidate and then as the director of corporate relations for UNH and as a mayor of Portsmouth before that, a lifetime resident of New Hampshire, if we do not act in a proactive manner with Superfund sites and with other environmental concerns that are going on right now, including the potability of water, as we're seeing around Pease, for example, in the town of Merrimack and other places, this isn't just an environmental issue. It's a public health issue, and it's becoming an economic issue. And because it is touching so many important parts of public policy in New Hampshire, we need to treat it with a heightened sense of prioritization. And that means that we have to look at state dollars in addition to collaboration with the private sector, all levels, federal, state, and local, to accelerate the cleanup for various projects. I'm not suggesting that there was a lack of concern in the past necessarily in these different parts of our state, but I think that there is increased information, increased awareness of the stakes involved environmentally, healthcare, and economically. And so I would be very proactive in building those partnerships to accelerate true remediation that can give people confidence that we're dealing with this with the intensity that it requires.
Lots of questions with federal angles coming in. We do want to get to some state issues as well. Would you repeal the business tax cuts that were passed under Governor Chris Sununu in this
I would absolutely repeal the business profits tax cut that has been done over the last several years. One, by the way, that my Democratic opponent in this primary voted for. She voted for the business profits tax cut. Now she says she opposes it, but in a debate with Chris Sununu, if we criticize Chris Sununu because he supported the business profits tax cut and he can turn his shoulder and say, well, you voted for those tax cuts, that is a very difficult argument for us to make, and it shouldn't be. It's $100 million a year of revenue that when I spent time as a director of corporate relations for UNH, I would ask them what they needed. You know what they didn't say? They didn't say, give me right to work. They didn't say, avoid a legitimate minimum wage. And they didn't say, please cut the business profits tax. They did say, I need people. We have the lowest birth rate in America, second highest median age in America, and an unemployment rate that is in the mid twos. Together, that is scaring the heck out of business leaders who are afraid that if they are successful, they are unable to fill a growing number of jobs they have. And so with that $100 million, among other things, I look at doing what they asked for, America's best outcomes in pre-K through 12 public education. I'm the only candidate on either side saying that we need pre-K as part of the mix. We're one of six states that don't do that. Invest in infrastructure. Invest in the way that we handle addiction and long-term recovery, and build this culture of entrepreneurship. I support the cut in the business enterprise tax, which hurts new businesses and young businesses disproportionately. But we should repeal the business profits tax cut of the last several years and invest it into the things that the very businesses are asking us to do.
Okay, another question, this one coming from Allison Senko. She asks, why do you support a $15 minimum wage now when just 2 years ago you called it, quote, very disruptive?
Well, I think that's completely out of context. The reality is that in certain parts of the state, even a $15 an hour minimum wage would likely not match the problem in the local economy. For example, in the Seacoast, where you have a very vibrant economy and a tremendous mismatch between supply and demand for labor. In other parts of the state, though, I have looked around the country, and the reality is Massachusetts, for example, is about to move to $15 an hour. Is that there is not an elegant way to do it other than to, over a 3 to 4 year period, move up to a $15 an hour minimum wage. You can give the business community a 3 to 4 year notice as we increase it, as Massachusetts and many other states are moving towards now. But the reality is that, unlike my opponent, I look at this as only one part of the conversation. A $15 an hour minimum wage is a part of a conversation about a living wage. And it should be that if you work 40 hours a week, you should be able to put food in your family's stomach, you should have a roof over your head, you should be able to have safe transportation to and from work and what you need to do, and you shouldn't have to worry about your health care. And I think we, as a state and as a country, are at a place where just talking about the minimum wage is not the complete conversation. It also talks about policy related to affordable housing, transportation policy, healthcare. This is all part of how people can live with dignity and some level of security in ways that they used to at one point. But in this economy where the growing gap between the have and have nots is blowing up, we need to address that in a proactive way or it will get worse.
This question comes from Jason Smith. He asks, are you for or against the death penalty?
I oppose the death penalty. And I also would, as governor, take the one person who is on death row and did something absolutely horrible, and I would commute it to life with no chance of parole. And the reason I say that is because I think if you believe the death penalty is wrong, and I do, then it's wrong not just tomorrow, it's also wrong today. And we should do what a number of other governors have done that feel the same way, and we should repeal it. And then we should commute to life without chance of parole for the person on death row in this case.
Shayla Almeida has just a statement. She says, stop Narcan. So it's tough to say what the context is here, but you do see this undercurrent sometimes, especially on social media, people who don't think that we should be reviving people who overdose repeatedly. I think there's some of that. I don't know if you've seen that at all. There are some people who express this thought that perhaps people are being given too many chances. That is obviously not a mainstream way of looking at things, but what do you think about this idea that Narcan being so widely available provides a kind of safety net that is, I guess, I'm not trying to make this person's point for them, but that they feel that we've gone too far in trying to rescue these people?
Well, I think just as a human, if we're going to be empathetic, when people are at a moment of true crisis, I think we need to do whatever we need to do to revive them, to save them, and to give them that chance. I think the bigger conversation, and I'm not sure the context of that particular comment, but it's moving us away in the conversation about addiction and recovery, away from a law enforcement tone and a short-term, 28-day, because that's what the insurance company will pay for sort of mentality, to what works, which is a healthcare-related conversation, holistic in nature. Honestly, it's kind of a lifetime conversation. The states that are having the most success use a more medically based hub and spoke system that recognizes that it's not just about detoxification from the addictive substance. It's also mental health. It's also wellness. It's about reconnecting with your loved ones, your community, the economy. A friend of mine in long-term recovery would say, and I think this is very wise, the opposite of addiction is not sobriety. The opposite of addiction is connection. And we need to think of policy as this complicated, sophisticated, long-term effort to reconnect people in places that are critical to their success in the future and their well-being, and requires a lot of work to reconnect them in many ways. And so if Narcan helps them get, saves their life, obviously we should go there. But then we need to think of this bigger to minimize the amount of relapse, because I know a lot of people in public safety are unfortunately treating the same people many times, and Narcan is often what is used in those moments. So we got to get away from the policies that lead us towards relapse.
Mm-hmm. And you hear from the first responders a lot that maybe it's that fifth or sixth or seventh time that they administer Narcan that the person does have that turnaround moment and they are able to change their life for the better. Okay, being a governor is all about those pocketbook issues. Doug Altman asks, sounds like a lot of increases. Where will you cut?
Well, there's a couple things. First is, there are places where I do talk about additional revenue. So I think we need to be candid about that. One is the reversal of the business profits tax cut. That's about $100 million a year. The second is, I do favor about a 4 cent a gallon increase in the gas tax. We have about 350 bridges that'll be on the red list over the next 10 years that need replacement or repair. And we don't have money for earmarked. So we got to get on that. So that is a way to do it, and legally it has to be attached to infrastructure. And then I have long favored and continue to the legalization, regulation, and taxation of cannabis for adult use. My estimate, because we're going to be surrounded by legalization by the end of the year, is about $35 million a year of revenue once fully implemented. The reality is that in terms of looking for places to save money, I've been auditing city, county, and state governments for the better part of 20 years. And I've learned about the best and worst run communities in the country. And one of the things that excites me the most about running for governor is I'm a proud progressive. My policies are right out there. I try to put the math behind them. But that there's an auditor's sensibility to how I look at solving the problems. My job, when you boil it down, is to identify the priorities that matter most, and then to find the most efficient way to sustainably deliver those outcomes. And to me, it's a never-ending search for more efficient ways to do it. In some cases, it can be collaboration or consolidation of various public services that are provided. No state in America has a higher administrative cost for a number of functions than New Hampshire, because more than any state in America, we continue to have a 19th century model of governance that basically says that often we're 234 cities and towns that happen to be drawn around one state border. In most of the country, they have found ways over the last 100 years, to be able to get collaboration between towns and drive down administrative costs and improve services. Really, if you get somebody like me in who has that auditor's pass and a data-driven approach to governance, you're going to find in the long run the ability to lower your property taxes and improve the quality of education, social services, and infrastructure. If we compared ourselves to the way many other states deliver those services, it would be amazing how just moving to a 20th century model of governance would allow you to feel a positive difference in your pocketbook and in the quality of the services you receive.
So there are some questions coming in that fall under that umbrella of changing the way the state is, and you're saying that it's time to bring us into the 21st century. But what do you say to those people who say that that is part of what makes New Hampshire special, that the New Hampshire advantage is there? You mentioned revenue. The things that we have in place in this state are part of what make us successful. What would you say to that argument that the things you propose would so dramatically change the state as to make us like the rest of the country, that that is a negative thing?
Well, the thing is, I love New Hampshire, I'm from New Hampshire, and I appreciate the unique qualities of New Hampshire. But when we talk about the New Hampshire advantage, that term gets thrown around a lot, often without specificity. The reality is that there's a lot of people paying a very high percentage of their income in state and local taxes. The way that they pay it may be different from the way that they would pay those same taxes and fees in other states, but do not be fooled. There are many, many New Hampshireites that are paying well in excess of 10% of their income in local property taxes every year. And the administrative cost, here's the example I often give. In New Hampshire, we have the second highest administrative cost per pupil of any state in America, and it's going up. And it is because the way we deliver it, we spend so much money in delivering education, and yet the difference between the way Claremont and Bedford, between Berlin and Windham, the discrepancy in the aid available at the local level for education is greater now than it was 30 years ago when the state first got sued and lost that lawsuit, what some of your listener viewers may know as the Claremont lawsuit. We lost that lawsuit, and we are poised to get sued again and lose that lawsuit again. And if we do not begin to get our arms around how we can deliver education and other services in a smarter way that is also fairer and is more sustainable, we are poised to lose that lawsuit again. Kids will be hurt in the process, and taxpayers ultimately will be hurt very much as well.
You mentioned education. Stephen says, Molly Kelly, your opponent, has said that she would freeze college tuition for New Hampshire universities. What does your plan do, and how much does it cost?
Yeah. So one difference between Molly and me, and there are many, is I think that Molly is very timid in terms of going after where public policy needs to go. I have a debt-free plan, and I can relate to this firsthand. I mentioned earlier the financial crisis that my family faced because we had a medical crisis. So then I applied to colleges, trying to be the first kid to go past high school. UNH said, congratulations, you're in, but you're paying the sticker price, which at that time was $13,000 a year. That was the highest in-state tuition in the country then, as it is now. Syracuse University came in a week later, and they said, we'll get it to you for $4,000 a year. So let's go Orange. I ended up going to Syracuse, stayed there for grad school. Eventually, I came back to New Hampshire, but a lot of my friends in similar circumstances did not come back to New Hampshire, and we suffer because of that. So I have a debt-free plan. Year one would cost about $4 million. The details are on the website, stevemarchand.com, and it basically says to the private sector, who is begging for talent and spending tons of money to recruit that talent and in lost productivity, you pay for half the tuition, we'll put a challenge grant for half the tuition for in-state students. We have a pilot program that begins it. I've had Republicans excited about it because it attaches dollars to real outcomes. And as long as those students work for a participating business or school district or similar New Hampshire-based entity for three or more years after they get their degree, we waive their debt. They have no debt. So it is a debt-free plan predicated on them sticking around in the state afterward. There are other states in the country that are far more Republican than ours that are doing similar and even more generous packages. There's no question that we can do it in a $6 billion a year operating budget. I'm talking about in year one, $4 million a year. If you have the auditor's background, if you've seen the best practices around the country, you can deliver outcomes that matter most at a price that we can sustain.
Speaking of workforce, there are people coming in with questions talking about the quote, the recent New York Times article on New Hampshire. We're going to assume they're talking about this workforce program where people in the state want to try and make this state more friendly to people of different ethnicities, that the state is 94% white and that we're looking to attract people as the state and the country change demographically, that we want to more accurately reflect that. This caused a little bit of a tempest, certainly on social media. What was your perspective on that?
If you look at the two biggest challenges New Hampshire faces, as I do, as our aging demography and the shrinking amount of entrepreneurship in our economy, it turns out that the population that if we can welcome and embrace and as part of our communities, that will do the most to help with both of those challenges is our immigrant communities, regardless of their race or their country of origin. We know, as my parents are examples, many people in Manchester and Nashua and around the state are examples. Immigrants start businesses at higher rates than native-born. They get patents at higher rates than native-born. They commit crimes, no matter what Donald Trump says, at lower rates than native-born, and they are employed at higher rates than native-born. The mere act of immigration is one of the most entrepreneurial actions an individual can take. I have seen it, I have lived it. It is challenging, it is difficult, it requires tremendous self-starting energy, and I have seen the positive power of immigration in my life and in my neighborhood on the west side of Manchester, and I know around the country, the states that are learning and understanding about how to integrate diverse cultures into their regions and their states are the ones that are getting the youngest and that are seeing the greatest burst of entrepreneurship. And those are the two biggest challenges we face in the next 20 years as a state.
Okay, Steve Marchand, we've hit a half hour here.
Okay.
We appreciate your time and taking all the questions, and thank you, all of you Facebook users, for chiming in with the questions for Steve, and we'll be back again tomorrow at 1 o'clock. Thanks for watching.